and what factors we need to think about before we get into the process. So, without much ado, I'm welcoming our speaker for today. That's Ms. Deepshikha Bhaumik. Some of you know her through LinkedIn, through professional commitments. But Deepshikha, as in short, I want to tell, is she is a people's person. You know, she was born to do people management, and she's an HR transformational leader, an out-of-the-box thinker, and a change agent. So she has been through a lot of cycles of change herself, personally and professionally both. So what better person to talk to us about performance management? And her expertise specifically to point out is between performance management, so people management, process management, and focused on organizational goals, which is very important nowadays, right? We can focus on individual growth, but aligning it to organizational goals, vision, mission is very important. So Deepshikha has been a pure catalyst in that role. She is a gold medalist for academic excellence in leadership and strategy from Great Lakes Institute of Management and has a dual graduation degree in law and humanities. So perfect blend for a human resource professional. Welcome, Deepshikha, and over to you. Yeah, I'll move the slides for you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Smita. That is a wonderful, wonderful introduction given. And I'm so really thankful to you for using such, choices, beautiful words to introduce me to the Coterie today. So today's discussion is on the balanced scorecard. And in order to take you through the entire concept, I have prepared some kind of an agenda. If you can show them the agenda, Smita. Right. So today we are going to discuss in the beginning why this session that we are doing, and then we'll ask you to share your feedback during the session and while the session is going on, and then after the session. And then what we are going to see is what are expectations of in terms of us from ourselves, from the management to us, and what is the delivery that we give, and where do we go wrong? So later on, we will see that how do we set our goals in order to streamline things better, and then how do we align organizational goals to your individual goals through coming through various departments and various SBUs, as you call it. And then we will see why do we use the tool of a balanced scorecard, and then we will see how do we do a bell curve. A lot of people keep asking that, what is the bell curve, how do we get it? And it's when the ranking system comes and we are like, okay, I did my 100%, I did my more than 100%, but I am not being rewarded similarly. So look at the concept of the balanced scorecard, and then we will come to the conclusion. So this is our agenda for the day. In between, you're free to ask questions anytime. You can stop me at any time. We will probably have a little bit of quizzing so that we keep on interacting amongst ourselves. This is a interactive session, and this is a session where we all pitch in and discuss what are the issues that we face in performance management in today's day, and what are the other tools that you could also suggest that we could also come and show you and make presentations on this later on. Okay, so as we were talking about the gap, expectation versus the delivery. Smita, can I please take control of the screen?
Yeah, you can just share it immediately. I'll stop sharing. Yeah,
Right.
do that now.
So you can see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay,
Yeah, you would have to do a slideshow for that, yeah.
I think, give me a sec, give me a sec. Yeah, so as we were talking about the gap between expectation and delivery, when we see that in a year, when you move from one quarter to the other, so the first two, three quarters, you are moving to some extent as you expected. And then slowly and gradually, at the end of the year, you see that the expectations remain as high as they were planned initially. And then there's a gap which starts coming in, and then up till a point, say this delta over here, the blue part, whereupon it is an acceptable gap and it is a takeable gap. But then slowly and gradually, we see that reality hits up, and this orange portion of it, where an unacceptable gap comes in, and the expectations are still high. And this is a very common thing in organizations where, as you see this guy with the cycle, he thinks that when you plan your journey to a particular goal, it is, it is a straight path. The flag is right in front of you. But when you hit the reality, you see that in order to reach from where you are to where you want to go, there are a lot of potholes, and there are jungles, and there are ropeways, and there are bridges, and there are cars, and there are a hell lot of disturbances when you want to be there. So the biggest, reality is the goal setting that we do. So what we need to discuss, what we need to understand is what are the goals? How do we set our goals? So there's a small snippet on how do you set a SMART goal. So when you say a goal setting, it should be a SMART goal, and it should be a goal where the goal is a specific one. It is measurable, it is achievable, it is relevant, it is target oriented. So when you say specific, it is direct, it is detailed, it is meaningful. Use action words. So I'll give you a small example. Maybe I'll pick up one of the BSCs over here. Let's take this. So the person says that the first goal is to buy reconciliation of quantity as per customer bill versus vendor bill as per invoice plan. So you're comparing the customer bill with the vendor bill as per the invoice plan, and you do reconciliation. Now look at the measurement this person has taken. Saving due to quantity reconciliation by value of vendor bill. The value of vendor bill is absolutely known to everybody. So number of vendors that we have. So it could be, say, 100 rupees a vendor bill. And then what is the quantity that you could reconcile into the percentage of saving? And the target over taken over here is 5%, which is a very nominal target, probably a doable target. So it is a specific goal. It is measurable because it is quantifiable. It can be tracked for progress. It is achievable. Just now we discussed that it's a 5% saving that we are talking about. It could be a 5% if the volume is huge, and 5% could mean the world to you, or not if it is a smaller one. So whether it is possible to accomplish it or not, and I have seen organizations going wrong a lot of times when upon we take up goals and we say that we have to take stretch goals, and so that people are, energized and enthused to actually hit the goals. But then many a times it becomes not possible to achieve, and hence people are demoralized. So you also have to understand when you're taking up your goals that whether they can be controlled, whether they can be influenced, whether there's an external person who will be influencing your goals tomorrow. Right. So whether they can be changed, they can be accomplished or not, is something which has to be understood, and you have to take goals which are achievable. And then they have to be relevant. So aligning to the company's objectives, whether they are relevant to the organization, whether your bosses are really looking for this to be done, whether it is in the scope of your action or not. Like if I say that I will bring in business of 100 crores to the organization, but I'm in the HR department, is it required? Are we really saying that we want you to do it? If not, I could always go and volunteer and say, yes, it is my good connections in the industry that I have done it. But if you are required to do, let's say, payroll on time, and you are bringing in business, and then you say, I have given a lot of business to the organization, but the organization is not looking for it. So alignment of the company's objectives to what you're doing, whether it is within the scope of the work, is very, very important. And then target orientedness, whether the goal has a deadline, whether there's a specific date, specific time mentioned for it, a year mentioned for it, or whether it is open-ended. So there are many people who take goals, especially at a senior management role, whereupon the goals are 2 years, 3 years, 4 years hence. And it is achievable. In like when we started doing the balance scorecard in my previous organization, we actually took a target of 3 years by which we should have done the implementation. So a number of years that you put in could be 1, could be 6 months, could be 3 months, could be a quarter. So what is this duration that you take? Hence, that's a smart goal. Okay, quick question over here. Anybody can tell me what is a full form of SMART?
Yeah, you can type it in the chat box.
Smita, I think it is measured. M is for measured. A is for achievable.
Okay.
What was R?
SM. M is for measurable.
Okay. Yeah, M is for measurable.
S is for?
S, I'm missing.
Okay.
M is for measurable. A is for achievable.
Very good.
And T is for time-based is what I remember.
Time-bound. Absolutely. Is that Neeti?
Yeah, that's Neeti here.
Wonderful. Okay, and Smita has also written S for specific. Okay, Pooja writes S for smart, M for measurable, A for achievable, R for relevant, and T for target-oriented. Bang on target, Pooja. Chalo, let's move on. Now we are talking about the goals cascading part. So now that we have taken a goal, we also have to understand whether we just talked about how relevant it has to be. So the organizational goals are aligned to the individual goals or not. And that has to be done through the department that you are in or through the business vertical that you are in. I'm sorry. Right. So there is a concept of cascading. And it is a Hoshin Kanri principle. So whereupon you take a goal, for example, let's say I am into recruitment and I am supposed to bring in 500 people to the organization. So if that is my goal, then I will take two initiatives. Say maybe one is through campus recruitment. Another is where by campus recruitment, I bring in around, let's say 200 students who are freshers. And the second would be lateral hiring. So I say, take a target of 300 lateral hiring through various portals and references and all that. Now, two of these initiatives that I have taken, I will cascade it to my team members, okay? Say I have four team members. So first one gets cascaded to two people and the second one gets cascaded to two other people. So of the second one, I take, say, 100 I give to one and 200 I give to another. And then out of the first initiative, I give 100 to one and 200, another 100 to another one. So there are two people in my team who does campus placement and two people in my team who does lateral hiring, and they know individuals' goals that are there. So from overall vision of the organization, what are you going to achieve is your objectives, and how are you going to achieve are through these measurements and through these targets and action plans, which are again known as the initiatives, right? From the organization, you come to the particular department or particular vertical, and from there to the individuals who are actually the ones who are doers. And then when you're done, it further goes back to the organization, and we start measuring whether the organization has achieved its goals through the individuals completing their goals, and then the departments completing their goals, and whether the organization has actually been able to complete their goals or not. So once that is done, then comes the feedback process. So what is the purpose of the feedback, and what do you want to achieve? How are you going to achieve that? Whether you have been able to achieve the desired results, and if not, then what are the things that needs to be done differently? This is where the requirement of PMS comes up. Okay. Just give me a second. So when we talk about doing the PMS, there are very many methods of evaluation that we do in organizations. There could be MBO, there could be 360 degree appraisals, there could be bars, there could be the balance scorecard, which we are talking about today, or the critical incidents diary, which organizations use. So out of all these, we are going to focus at one today, which is the BSC. So what is a balanced scorecard? The balanced scorecard is basically a strategic planning and management system used to align business activities to the vision and strategy of the organization by monitoring performance against the strategic goals. So because it provides a more balanced view whereupon not only the financial targets are the ones that are the organization is bothered about, but there are also the customers, their perspective, which is important to the organization, and how the processes are changing in the organization, that is important. And the growth of the organization depending on the learning of the employees, which is also given focus. So we call it balanced because we are taking care of all the facets, all the aspects that an organization could address when you are talking about overall performance appraisal of the organization. So BSC is the sixth most widely used management tool across the globe, and more than half of major companies in US, Europe, and Asia are using the balanced scorecard approach. Okay, in a while, there'll be another question answer round coming up, so stay tuned. So what does the BSC do? Basically, what it does is it takes the vision of the organization, breaks it down to objectives, and then takes it to the strategy, whereupon you find out that in the financial perspective, if we succeed, how do we look to towards our shareholders? In the customer perspective, it says that in order to achieve our vision, how should we look appear to our customers? What are the things that they should focus on for us? And then in order to impress the customers, what are the processes that we must internally excel at within the organization? And in order to excel at the processes, we have to know the processes, learn the processes, and hence have a focus on the learning and growth perspective. So how must the organization learn? So these are some of the examples that I have put in while I talk about the balanced perspectives. So if you look at this, the financial perspectives is the market share or the revenue growth or the return on investment or the financial productivity of the organization overall. They can be classified in the financial perspective. In the customer perspective, you can classify how much is the customer service that you're providing, what all new markets are you entering, what is the percentage of the market share that you have in the current market of whatever you're producing or whatever you're servicing. And then the customer retention, that how much percentage of customers were there last year, out of them, how many you have retained and how many have actually gone away. And then the customer satisfaction and loyalty, that whether the people who are being retained, whether they are loyal to the organization and they are satisfied with the organization, or they're just because they're just there because they're not being able to get a better replacement. Then in the internal process perspective, I'll just give you some examples where regulatory processes, social processes, let's say ISO certification, or the site safety incidents, or implementation of 5S. In the organization, or some kind of operational management ERP tool like SAP or SuccessFactors and stuff like that that you have implemented, comes under the process perspective. So any kind of, let's say, SOP that you develop comes under the internal process perspective. And then the learning and growth perspective, whereupon how do you train yourself? Have you taken number of trainings that you've taken, whether there's a leadership pipeline which is being built or not, whether there's attrition in the organization, whether it is being checked. And then if there are innovation processes which the organization has taken up, if the employees are contributing to it, how much percentage of innovation ideas have been given and they have been accepted by the management and stuff like that. So coming from a few of these examples that we put in. Okay, so it's the quiz time now. I had given some example over here whereupon we have said entering new markets. Which perspective is it? Entering new markets. Shall I write it down in the chat box? which perspective does it come into? Entry in new markets. Writing the SOP of a process. Okay, entry in the new markets is customer perspective. Pooja says so. Okay, Smita says so too. Thank you. Yeah, you're right. Okay, writing the SOP of a process.
That's the second one. Whatever the second one was.
Internal process? Okay, great. Okay, great. What about innovation ideas? Savita and Pooja, both of you are right. Writing an SOP comes under the internal process, of course. And what about innovation ideas? Okay. Pratik, you're right. Pooja, you're right too. The learning and growth perspective. Okay, one more. Profit percentage. Or the revenue. Finance perspective. That's right. Okay, great. So when we are writing down a BSc, ideally what we need to do before writing down a BSc of an organization, we need to understand the... So we need to understand that... these four perspectives and how do we divide the entire organizational objectives into these four perspectives. When you are talking about the financial perspective, it is the cost efficiency, it is the revenue growth, it is the long-term shareholders value that you have to keep in mind. So from there, automatically flows down the customer perspective. So what are the customers worried about? The price of the product or the service, the quality, the you know, service delivery, how fast is it, how efficient is it, the availability of that particular product in the market or the service, how fast do you get it and how quickly do you get access to the person, and the brand value of the organization. So there's a concept called top of mind awareness or TOMA, which is like when I talk about, let's say take a photocopy, we usually talk about which company?
Xerox,
exactly. So the TOMA creates an kind of customer delight, which automatically goes to the financial well-being, okay, revenue growth. In the internal process, operational management processes and CRMs and innovation processes and regulatory social processes, all these are in the internal process, which again come from human capital, organizational capital, information capital. Now, in the last slide, I had told you innovation comes under which perspective? Did I tell you that it comes under learning and growth perspective, right? But hereupon, we see that it also comes under the internal process. So when the innovation process is in place, let's say some kind of value engineering, then it gets into the internal process. But when you are getting it figured out, when you are giving in ideas, it goes under the learning and growth perspective. There could also be a fifth perspective called the innovation perspective, or another sixth perspective whereupon social responsibility perspective, you can call it. So these are the things that can be brought in. You can add more perspectives, not necessarily that you have to keep in only these four. You can reduce one of them. If you think that the first 2 years, you do not want to measure anything about internal processes and you just want to benchmark the financials and you benchmark the learning and the customer, then you can also do it. So I'm going to show you one example of how from organization you can come to a frontline scorecard making. So when the organization says very naive kind of a target, increased profit margin. When you talk about increased profit margin, what does the department at a particular business vertical say? Probably optimize cost of production. So we are talking about in a plant kind of an environment. This okay, so optimize the cost of production, reduce the inventory level. So from that particular division, when it comes to there are 2-3 plants producing the same kind of thing, so it will look into the yield ratio, the labor productivity, then reducing the inventory levels. Now when you come to the last executive, to him, what does yield ratio mean? How does he put it in his own BSC? So he probably writes down reducing waste, reducing overtime, increasing the production rates. So the moment you increase the production rate, it automatically increases labor productivity, yield ratio, and then it automatically optimizes the cost of production and hence increases profit margin. So what I'm trying to show by this slide is the organization takes up goals, and then the division understands each of these statements and each of these goals and makes their own goals, which again comes to the individual as in order to take that divisional goal, what does that individual need to do? And it is essentially the departmental heads who need to put into the thought process. So I'm showing you one of the draft organizational BSCs that we had planned in my previous organization for this year 2021. And so it's a very simple one, and it's a very lucid one for people to understand up till the last executive, as I keep saying, because it's very, very important to trickle down that idea down below. And I have seen whereupon organizations have taken their goals and the departmental heads have taken up goals and they understand, but there's a huge gap when it comes to the person sitting in the reception, or a person who is chasing the production, or a person who is standing in the project in the sun and he's getting the a bridge built. The connection between them loses out. So to begin with, on a first year basis, this is the kind of organizational BSC an organization can take up. Say, in order to increase revenue, you can straight away say, we want to increase the gross margin, we want to increase the turnover. And in order to bring in financial stability, you reduce the debt to equity ratio, you reduce the average collection period. In the customer perspective, you could say that in order to increase the market share, increase the existing order value that you have, enter new markets. So identify the markets that you want to enter. What are the sunrise sectors that you want to go into? Or there are sectors which you are not good at, you have not been successful in the past, you want to enter them. And then in the customer perspective, you could take customer satisfaction, which is a very popular thing in every BSC, you will see this. So bring in customer feedback. And a lot of organizations, very well-to-do organizations, I have seen there is no customer feedback mechanism. So if the customers call to a particular project manager, the project manager escalates it to the particular department, and then the particular department writes emails. And in the entire process, it gets lost that how many complaints came up and how many complaints got resolved, what are the number of hours taken to complete give complete resolution, and whether a satisfaction has been taken after that or not. So there is a big gap, especially in manufacturing kind of setups. And then implementing the customer complaint redressal method. So once the initial part is done, whereupon we start taking feedbacks, then we can have this redressal method put in. In the processes, improving the quality standards, improving the supply chain, improving delivery, ensuring safety and regulations. So when you talk about improving quality standards, what we mean is reduce the cost of quality, reduce the cost of bad quality, increase the cost of good quality, enhance average pay period. So how much time we take the cycle to pay off our vendors, and how much time we take to get receivables from our customers, these two cycles. So getting the money from the customer faster and paying to the vendors later, the bigger the cycle is, the better profits for the organization. Improving delivery, the number of projects completed without liquidated damages, and this is one of my directors keep saying, so we have completed the project all hunky-dory, and then when the bill comes, we see that there are a lot of damages, liquidated damages given, a lot of penalties have been imposed on us. The huge number of profit, chunk of the profit goes away because of the liquidated damages. So when you say about delivery, it is not only completion on time, but also you have to understand that there are no penalties put in. Ensure safety regulation. So what we mean by this is we could reduce the lost time due to injuries. So you can measure it by the number of accidents happening, the number of incidents taking place, the number of breaches that has happened. And in the learning, we could take maybe find and attract the right talent, develop the right talent, ensure compliance. So when you say find and attract right talent, you could reduce the hiring tax, which means there are 50 positions that the organization needs to close, out of which all of them need to be done maybe in 1 month's time, on an average 1 month's time. Developing the right talent, so by inculcating a value-driven learning culture, which would be that number of trainings that you have imparted, how they are impacting people's lives, whether the trainings are required by the individual or not, if there are feedbacks coming up, if there are assessments taken, and whether the work is really improving, behaviors are really improving or not. So that will bring some value to them. Ensure compliance, reducing holdups, implementing the compliance scorecards. And this is an entirely a new world whereupon you say that every compliance department has to have series of deadlines that they have to match, and having zero tolerance towards any non-compliance. The organization taking their scorecard, which means giving a focus. All of these are taken thinking of the fact that how much is the organization towards that particular goal? How much the organization is focusing in that particular perspective? And that is how an organization BSC can be drafted. So I'll show you in, from one of my experiences of the past that, see, once the organization has taken particular targets in a year, the next year, the targets are all enhanced. So net turnover in crores, 900 crores was the first year's target. I'm talking about some kind of startup. Okay. And the next year, the targets are enhanced. So once you take the first year's targets, when you're beginning with doing a balanced scorecard, the initial year will only go in measuring what are the things that you need to do and where are we standing right now. So that is the most difficult part, because a lot of things that we think in the initial year, with my personal experience, I will tell you that we are mostly not being able to manage it at the end of the year. So I know that I have to get 900 crores as a net turnover, but at the end of the year, I see I've got only 600 crores. So there could be two scenarios for it. One could be a COVID kind of a situation whereupon though we have taken the correct numbers, but we have not been able to come up to it because of a certain situation. Or we have actually misjudged the markets. Our calculations were wrong, our analysis was wrong, hence we took a target of this sort. So again, profit before tax. So the organization took in the initial year 12% profit before tax, and then they understood that this is too ambitious, it is not doable. And there are projects in it who are not even doing 5%, 6%. So the next year, they reduced that target. Third one is ROCE, which is earning before tax. So it is basically current assets minus current liabilities. In the first year, we have taken a target of 55% of EBIT by current assets, by current liabilities, which means earning 55% higher. The next year, we understood it was too high, so we reduced to 43%. So first year, you just measure where we're standing, and you take an organizational goal overall. And then the next year, you see that how much are, what have we been able to take. And then next year, you take your next year's goals. I'm showing the HR scorecard. A lot of people over here are from the HR domain, and I was told to specifically show something about the HR. So this is a very simple, basic scorecard that I could show you. Whereupon, see, the business perspective talks about recruitment, the customer perspective, recruitment, and the HR budget. The customer perspective talks about the roles, responsibilities, and job descriptions of individuals in the department, and also measures the happiness quotient of the organized. The internal perspective talks about completion of HR processes on time, reducing the rate of attrition, and having an admin compliance card, scorecard that needs to be put in place. In learning and growth, they have taken developing a talent pool, identifying hypos and hypers, and building a leadership team, adherence to PMS guidelines, and preparing the BSc and one-on-one review, develop a map, skill development metrics, 180 degree evaluation of positions like AGM and above. So for senior positions only, 180 degree evaluations, and then determine and track the mandatory training hours. So these are some of the initiatives that the HR department could take, and they could be measured very, very specifically. Like when you talk about closing positions, timeline of 30 days on an average. When you talk about HR budget, variance from the budget should not be even 1%. So you stick to whatever budget you had taken. Developing unique roles and responsibilities. The measurement is number of job descriptions made by number of work levels. If we have 10 work levels, out of them, how many job descriptions are made? This is done, kept in mind that in a lot of organizations, the work levels are so huge, and people do not focus on the lower levels. They are usually the, up till manager grade that we get JDs, and then later on in the, as we go down the hierarchy, it gets fizzling out. So this is a very interesting one, and this is something that I put in there in my previous organization. Measuring happiness quotient of the organization by ESAT, or employee satisfaction survey, and improve it over the years. So how do you measure it? Number of employees participating in the survey in the initial year. And the initial year, when the participation has happened, in the next year, we would measure that out of the people who have participated and told, given us a score. So that was the initial happiness quotient that we have. In the next year, we need to increase that happiness quotient. So the first year, it is just participation of the employees ensuring that is what we had taken as a time. Then another one, compliance, HR processes completion, or rate of attrition. So number of deviations should be zero. That is what the target we had taken. Rate of attrition, we had decided, see, initial years, we had very, very high attrition in this organization. We had 36% attrition when I joined the organization. And when I left it, after 3.5 years, we found out that the attrition is around, 4 to 5%. And it only happened because we started measuring it. First year, when I joined in, there was some measurement of attrition, and I actually figured out there's 36% attrition happening in that organization. So I started measuring it month on month, quarter on quarter, and then tell the management that who all are leaving, which manager is letting go more people, which manager is actually being able to retain people, how many people have been upgraded in a particular department by a particular manager, and whether the upgradation has been done, because of the manager or because of the management and their intervention and stuff like that. A lot of analysis after doing them, we had seen in the third year that the attrition has come down to 8%. Then in the learning and growth, developing a talent pool. So in the initial year, we had taken a target of having an assessment, penetrating an assessment. So we have taken the 20% of the hierarchy. So top 20% comes into that particular assessment, whereupon out of that top 20%, we figure out who are the hypos and whom do we want to train, whom do we want to give higher positions. We want to do a career graph mapping and charting of these employees only. Then develop and map a skill development matrix. When you say skill development matrix, then skill matrix ratings of each person to be done. And by 1-1 means 100%. Adherence to PMS, this is very interesting. So because we started in the first year, there was no PMS measurement given. And then people were like, this is difficult. We don't want to get measured. And it obviously tells the management that itna kaam mujhe karna tha, maine itna kiya hai. So I don't want to do an PMS. Initial year, always there's huge kind of resistance. But the moment you put it into their own scorecards, saying that you have done your PMS, your team members have done their PMS, bang on. Immediately, all the forms will come to you on time. They could be wrong, they could be modifiable, they could be better feedbacks given, but having people to start off with an incentive, putting in this particular scorecard that everybody individually, whatever you, there are four key things that you want to be, you know, done by somebody. You put in the scorecard and you see that people have actually started focusing on this because they know that this particular thing is going to be measured. So me being in HR, whether I bring in more business or not, will not matter. If I be able to, you know, put the processes in place without any deviation or bringing down the attrition, or I able to do a ESAT on time, or I be able to close the positions within 30 days of coming in or not, these are the things that will matter, right? So this is again a BD scorecard. Order booking, entering new businesses, estimated margin of orders. That is in the business perspective, very clear ones. Customer perspective would say monthly reviews with the project teams to understand what their difficulties are. Timely return of non-fund based and instruments like your you know, bank guarantees and EMDs, and then unsuccessful bids ke liye the money, that earnest money that you deposit. In internal process, what can BD do? Creation of contractors list, consultant list, vendor data bank, wherever you're going into, you know, the sunrise sectors that you go into. Minimizing the variation in order booking plan. What is that? Firstly, you get orders, and that is not where the work of BD stops. They have to understand, they have to ensure that orders pile up at one point of time. They have to be coming in phases, you know, quarter one and quarter two and quarter three and quarter four, because what we have seen in my previous organization, this has been my experience, when BD brings in business, it's a huge lot. And there's obviously backlogs happening because it is not coming in a phase-wise manner. So we have to plan at the beginning of the year that these are the businesses which are going to come up and these are the projects which are going to open up. Out of them, how much we are going to bid in and how much are we going to accept in one quarter. That is how order backlogs will not get into, you know, into the system. Controlling rate of attrition. We had given this particular initiative in all the departments. All the verticals need to ensure that there are no attrition from their own departments, their own verticals. Unless and until you take up organizational objectives in your own departmental scorecards, you're not going to meet the organization objectives. Skill development initiative. Every person we had given this. Training man hours, where whoever took 16 hours, 16 hours, whoever took 8 hours, 8 hours for the entire organization, it was 4 hours of mandatory training for every person in the organization. And if it is not happening, we used to make these bars and graphs and show the management, ki ye vertical se number of training hours complete nahi hue, wo vertical se over ho gaye. So people who were taking too much of trainings, they were like, stop taking trainings. And then people who are not taking trainings at all, they were being questioned, being assessed, and found out what is the problem with them, whether they were overworked or not, whether they're interested or not, whether they really want to grow up or not. And then if you link the, you know, appraisals with that, that if you are going to become a manager in the next 3 years, obviously, it becomes, they become more serious in trainings. I think Sunil is here, one of my colleagues from my previous organization, and he will be able to tell us more about this procurement. But just look at this, savings on budget direct expenses, average pay period in days, timely delivery of material, feedback from customers, bill reduction on basis of incomplete compliance, vendor enlistment, vendor evaluation, maintaining and circulating a price tracker index, participating in mandatory or non-mandatory trainings. Okay, so this is the one but last slide, whereupon after that we go into a quick quiz break. I had showed you the scorecards of many departments up till now. Now, a lot of people ask me this question, that what are the maximum or minimum weightages that we should take? So on a balanced view, it should always be that the business perspective has 25% and the learning has 25% and the customer has 25% and the process has 25%. So it is a balanced view. If you take away one of them, then the balance bigger jata hai. But is it always possible for a finance person to take, learning of 25% and only keep business to 25% limited? It's not possible. So we had taken, and in a concept note of Norton and Kaplan, you'll see that anything above 30% in a perspective makes it more important than the others. Anything below 15% makes the perspective insignificant. So a balanced view has to be kept in any kind of balance scorecard when you make them. Okay, a quick quiz time. Hi, Sunny sir. Thank you for your tips, sir. Okay, my question is to everybody. We just spoke about a balanced view, right? What should be the ideal percentages of each of these four perspectives in a BSc? Okay, Pooja and Pratik says 25%. Savita also says 25%. But what could be the maximum? And what could be the minimum? Wow, Savita, you are absolutely bang on target, and I see you responding very fast and very to all the questions almost. Yes, that's true. Avinash also says 30 and 15. Pooja says 30% max. Pratik Solanki says 30 max and 15 mean. All of you are right. All of you are right. Great. Moving on. I want to show you in the next slide. The relation between the four perspectives, right? So look at this one. This is a scorecard of the procurement division. So to begin with, we start off with, let's say, training on SAP. That comes under learning. When you have a good training on SAP, it automatically transfers into creating POs within a particular timeline, releasing them faster, more efficiently. So when your POs are done on time, the materials get delivered just in time and the average billing cycle gets enhanced. So because you have taken a good training on SAP, you are being able to do your POs correctly, you are able to do your purchase requisitions correctly on time. All the stuff that you're supposed to write down in that particular pro forma are correctly written. The project understands, the procurement guys understand, the delivery guys understand. Obviously, the materials are going to be delivered on time. And that the moment you're, so there's a concept of just in time in procurement, not too long and not too short. If it is too short, then obviously the production stops. If it is too long, then warehouse inventory goes up. So you have to have materials delivered just in time. And you know, if you do that correctly, then the average billing cycle enhances. Let's look at an example of the quality department. Hiring stat streamline. You would arguably say that hiring stat is basically for an HR division, right? But in quality division also you need people. So you take in, This is for the HR department. Hiring TAT streamlined, it directly transpires to manpower schedule being on place, which means that you're starting off a project, you say that first 3 months we need 50 people, next 3 months you need 100 people, उसके बाद नेक्स्ट थ्री मंथ्स वी नीड 150 पीपल सो दैट शेड्यूल एज पर द हायरिंग टैट इफ वी हैव प्री प्लान्ड इट देन वी विल बी एबल टू स्टे ऑन शेड्यूल एंड ऑल द मैंडेटरी पोजीशंस एज पर द गवर्नमेंट ऑर्डर्स दैट वी गेट आर फिल्ड ऑन टाइम हेंस देयर आर नो होल्ड अप्स इन बिजनेस हेंस द बिजनेस perspective gets enhanced. So a while before we were talking about how in organizations having these hold ups is so important because you can have your projects delivered on time and then you see a lot of penalties have been put. And so it takes away from the profit. You do all the hard work, you deliver on time, but if there are penalties, then there is the fruit of your hard work goes away. So having the mandatory positions filled up on time is also a very important perspective. Come to the projects department over here. Where is the projects department? Yeah. So capturing the project learnings. A lot of people say that, "Ha, project ho gaya, khatam ho gaya. Band karo chapter and move on to the next one." But if you do the project learnings capturing properly, then you will be able to understand what are the hindrances that has happened in the previous project. What are the risks that you ran into? And then in a similar kind of project, in a similar different kind of an environment, you will be able to assess the environment better and will be able to come out with better solutions. So the processes can enhance if you capture the project learnings correctly. And hence, you can do a better project negotiation with the next customer. Say, for example, if the project is delayed because due to rains, or the project is delayed because of a situation like COVID, or a project is delayed because of a situation where maybe there's a market crash happening because of the government falling. So all these things, if you put into the contract and if you say the rate of the manpower, the rate of the, you know, every milestone will go up because of these factors if they factor in. And this learning will only come to you when you have actually written down the project learnings. So the better contract negotiation terms for the next project. So Sani sir being here in this training, he will be able to say that how we stand up to our customers and say that ye project ke jo, the contract terms and conditions that you have given are need to be revised or these are not acceptable to us. It is a very common thing when organizations talk about it, but only when you have noticed down the project learnings and you have known that these are the risks which are going to come up and these are the hindrances and we need to address them. The moment the contract negotiation terms are correctly done, then there are obviously higher margins. Again, taking in another department, let's say quality. So people say that ISO is just paper these days. I am telling you, QMS ISO awareness, we started in our organization. We had, of course, we had ISO before we started the awareness, but when we started doing awareness sessions, we could see the inspections were automatically done on time or they were actually being given more importance because in your BSCs, we had put inspection timelines within 24 hours of inspection, call inspections have to be done. So the moments are inspections are happening on time, the rejections, the wastages, they reduce. Because you must have seen in product kind of an organizations where you're making products, you bring in material, you do not inspect them, you just put them into work. And later on when the materials are rejected, there are losses to the tunes of crores. Just because that inspection was not happening, it could not happen in 24 hours, all that rejection wastages happened. So the moment you reduce the rejections and the wastages, the cost of quality obviously reduces. But this will only happen when you are able to put in the particular departments, particular SBUs, you know, scorecard, that what are the things that you need to focus on and prioritize on. Once that is done, and a PSC has been correctly formulated, now it will come to the rankings. So I was just showing you one of the BSCs whereupon, let's talk about the HR BSC. Okay, let's take this one, quality BSC. So we had seen that there are targets over here, target mid-year, target end-year, and then there'll be actual mid-year and then actual end-year. And then we will go to the achievement percentages. The moment you come to achievement percentages, there will be rankings done, right? Where the concept of the bell curve comes in. Now, I need people's utmost focus over here. So what is the bell curve? in a department of 10 people, there always has to be rankings in order to understand who are the people who should be given promotions, who are the people who should be given increments, and what should be the increment percentage of each and every person. So I have given you an example of a department of, say, 100 people. Okay. So there are 60 people at the middle, as you can see, 15 at the two sides, and at the extreme ends, there are 5 each. This is an ideal bell curve, which means in an organization, we ideally say that only 5% people we will consider as poor performers, or only 5% people we will consider as excellent achievers. It is the baseline, the consistent contributors who keep on meeting their expectation year on year, which means mujhe jitna karne bola tha, maine utna kiya hai. That is a chunk of people, and that is a 60% people of the organization. Year on year, I have seen this happening. So people who have done 90% to 99% of their targets are the consistent contributors in organizations. People who have exceeded their targets are the high achievers, and they are usually the 15% people. And people who have, you know, exceeded expectations to a large extent are the ones who are the excellent achievers. And this is the ideal bell curve as organizations move. Now I'm going to show you some actual bell curve from an actual organization. And these are, last year's rating numbers that I'm showing you. Persons who were rated poor, this one person over here, huh? Poor rating. I'm sorry, the scaling is not correctly done. Okay, now it is better, I think. So one is poor performer, two is performer, three is consistent contributor, four is high performer, and five is excellent achiever. So we see here, poor performer is one, performer is 12, consistent contributor is 37, high achiever is 8, excellent achiever is none. This is the actual one. And this could be an ideal one, whereupon we do not expect anybody as poor performer. We expect probably one or two people to be excellent, 9-10 people to be high achievers, and the consistent contributors could be 60% people as usual and 26 as performers. So we have this bell curve mapped out, whereupon the expected, the actual, and the expected one are mapped. So what we do is, in every division, in every department, we make this departmental bell curve. Under you, there are 10 people. You make that 10 people's bell curve. Your boss has 100 people, so he makes all the 100 people's bell curves. And then the organization has 1,000 people, so the organization will take all small bell curves, put them into the correct shape, and find out who are the overall 60% people who are the majority. Basically, we do not look at that 60%. We look at the outliers, as we call them. The performers, the poor performers, the high achievers, and the excellent achievers. And they are the ones who are treated. So either you give them PIPs if they are a poor performer, or maybe poor performers are asked to go. You give PIPs to the performers. You give promotions to the excellent achievers. And you give increments, good amount of increments, to the high performers. And you give an average increment to the consistent contributors. So that is what the actual bell curve does. It ranks people in order to their contribution, but a lot of organizations are doing away with bell curve because they want to just take a scorecard, give the scores according to what you have done, and not size you according to the ranking in the department. So this is one of the scorecards of one of my colleagues, whereupon the achievement percentage, the achievement percentage over here says, .4, which would mean ideally he's a consistent contributor, so he will get his rating as consistent contributor. We are not going to judge them according to the ranking, and that is how a lot of organizations are also moving on. But when you are initially started on with PMS, then it is always good to do a bell curve. It is always good to do a ranking. That is how people are aligned with the organization. I know what is expected out of me. If I be able to do it, then I get this kind of a score. It is prim and proper and well defined at the very beginning of the year. And that is how success comes to an organization. A quick quiz time before we end up with the session. My question to all the people who are here. Okay, we spoke about the bell curve. What is an ideal bell curve? Maybe how many people could go as consistent contributors? Pratik, Avinash, Vijay. Hi, Vijay. That's right, 60. Okay, what could be the number of, let's say, high achievers? No, Pratik, 5 is too less. 15 is the right one. Okay, what could be for poor performers? Savita says 5, Pooja says 5, Vijay says 5. Excellent. Correctly done. So, so this is where we come to the conclusion of it. And I really want to emphasize on this fact that I have seen this happen year on year, that what gets measured gets achieved. The moment you say that I want to reduce attrition, the moment you say I want the learning hours to go up, the moment you say I want to measure people's deliverables and not their attendance, you put it in their PMS sheet, you put it in their scorecards, and you see people actually being able to deliver according to the words put in the PMS. And if you review it twice a year, better if you do it quarterly, there are 100% chances that people will start behaving in a way they are desired to behave like, because they are getting measured. So other than this part also, there is a talent management piece whereupon the behavioral part is being measured. But when you're talking about performance management and the balanced scorecard, we focus on only the performance and we do not bring in behavior over here, because then we keep it, tight to the only to performance. So if we want to bring in, let's say, a 9-box matrix, then we have to judge the potential and the performance of people, and the potential assessment will come under the talent management piece, which will be another day's topic. So I think I am done with my presentation here, and
Thank you so much, Deepshikha, and it was such a you know the topic very well. We could make that out. And I would just request if people want to connect to you to know more about this, because 1 hour is something which is very less to, cover the entire topic. And if anyone wants to connect and design their balanced scorecard, would you be available for that, Deepshikha?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Can you just put your, credentials in the chat box too, so they can follow Thanks, Deepshikha, so much.
My email is deepshi@gmail.com and my number is 7890401259.
Okay. We have a question from Savita, which says that my question is in a very first slide of BSc where gap is initially started. Can you have any idea to stop the gap?
Can we have any idea to stop the gap?
Yeah.
So once the gap has started happening, there is no stopping until and unless there is a mid-year assessment done. And mid-year assessments are very pertinent in many organizations, because wherever you have a BSc, you got to have these mid-year assessments done. It is very important, and that is the time when you can say that we are going south. Let's maybe change our goals or change our managers, change the team, or do something in order to put it back on track, or maybe bring down the expectations of the organization. And if I'm finding it difficult in the quarter one and quarter two, obviously by the mid-year, I will go up to my manager and say, boss, I'm not being able to do this. This is not achievable. These are the problems that I'm facing. Let's address them. Otherwise, let's reduce the target. So yeah, it can be changed the midway.
Okay, thanks Deepshikha. I don't see any more questions, but I'm sure people will definitely connect one-to-one, so cover this vast topic. Thanks everyone for the feedback, for the candid feedback. And guys, thank you for joining us today. We'll come back with the HR webinar series with our next speaker, Miss Yogita Parab, and she will be covering a topic on people management. So stay tuned, be connected to us on LinkedIn, where we will post this and we'll send the invite to you all. So thank you so much for connecting.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Thanks, Deepshikha. Yep. Thank you, everyone.
Take care, everybody.
Have a nice weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Deepshika. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Take care, Vijay. Take care, Prateek.
Yeah.
Thanks. Bye. Thanks for attending, Pooja. Thanks for attending, Savita. It was great to interact with all of you. Okay, guys, so this was the session. And if you have any questions, if you have any queries, please come back to me. Write to me at deepshi@gmail.com and connect to me over LinkedIn. And, you know, let me know what are the things that were right, what are the things which were wrong, and what are the things that you want to know from me more. And let us connect more. Thank you.